and the failure of News on Sunday, and sort of like talk to you about why Manjean was involved in these two newspapers. Okay, I'm going to talk to you first a little bit about the background in Britain in the 80s. So we start with the return of the Conservative Party to power, with the election of Margaret Thatcher as Prime Minister in 1979. And so after 5 years of Labour government, under Thatcher's, and Britain under Thatcher saw huge economic, demographic and cultural change. And so basically in economy, Britain was in, it was a period of neoliberal economics. Britain was in two major recessions, but they still maintained managed to maintain 2.2% of GDP growth, levels that we would be happy to have today. Furthermore, by the end of the 80s, the growth in Britain was one of the largest in Europe. Also, inflation in the 70s rocketed, so a lot of Thatcher's policies were aimed at reducing this inflation, but this took a toll on unemployment, which rose to 3 million as a record high in 1984. Public spending generally went up, and most state-owned companies were being made private. Also, we talk about trade unions. They were a great force in the 70s as well, where one in each four Britons were actually a member of one. This in the 80s as well lost a lot of power, and also we have the strikes, which was a great problem in the 80s, with the workers demanding better conditions and higher salaries. That the most famous strike was the miners' strike, as we have in the picture, where it went on for a whole year from 1984 to 85, and in the end they got defeated. Next one. The newspaper industry at the time, well, we're speaking of a time where the right wing completely dominated, and Margaret Thatcher was known to be the Queen. As Kevin Mosley, a journalist from the newspaper, the News on Sunday, quoted. Right-wing newspapers would support Mrs. Thatcher in her policies, and generally the media just wouldn't dare to attack her. And the left, because of this, felt that they had nowhere to go. However, committed left-wingers, though, thought that if they could rally support for their cause by publishing a newspaper, they could become bigger. So they wanted to tell the truth. Even if it was to be known as their truth, it was still another side to the story. And so the News on Sunday appears. It was launched in 1987, and only 2 months after it went bankrupt. We have Hayling, which was at the head of all this. He left Cambridge with a double first degree. He went on to work for the Ford company for 8 years, and he was a member of the Big Flame organisation, which was very left wing. We have Keith Sutton as well, who was also involved. He was from a working class background. He was working at Fleet Street at the time, and he dreamt of political activism at that time. So basically they got together, and they gathered around them people that were like-minded left-wingers, and so they sat down to develop a mass-market newspaper. And they developed a dummy paper which was to be market researched, and the feedback came back that they could expect to sell 1 million copies a week. But before going for investors, Hayling realised that they needed a proper journalistic figurehead to go on ahead with this, which was to be John Pilger, the main left-wing journalist at the time.
meaning that no demographics were excluded. This helped give the Mail and Sunday the competitive advantage that they needed to stand out from other tabloids, to optimise circulation, and to start turning over a profit. Now, the News on Sunday also struggled with similar startup problems, such as poor circulation and a lack of relevant content. But what also hindered the News on Sunday's progress was the obvious lack of organisational structure within the business. There was no clear leadership, and a lack of internal divisions meant there was many arguments between staff. For example, conflict arose due to two dummy papers being produced in rival with each other, creating tension between colleagues. Internal conflict means negative effect on morale, and motivation would have suffered. As Gabrielle mentioned earlier, there were large numbers of unqualified applicants for journalist roles, and that means that the News on Sunday had many employees which were more like enthusiastic amateurs rather than experienced journalists. In the meantime, the Mail on Sunday recruited a good editor and a strong team of journalists, probably due to their connection with the Daily Mail. Another contributing factor which hindered the News on Sunday's success was their actual news content, which, much like the Mail on Sunday's first sports page, was rather irrelevant, with people describing it as bland and nondescript. The headlining article in the first edition was about a Brazilian man who had to sell his kidney. This is something that people would find hard to relate to in the UK, as it's such a different culture to that of Brazil. And furthermore, it's not an article you'd want to read over your Sunday breakfast. However, I would say the main reason they failed was due to their general lack of experience. There was no clear management structure, and changes in leadership and differing objectives meant that decision-making was really slow, hindering the progress and eventually resulting in the failure to survive as a business. So what management lessons have we learned from comparing these two businesses? Firstly, I want to talk about leadership, which can be one of the major factors in determining success or failure of a business. As you have seen today, the News on Sunday had major problems with leadership. Alan Hayling, the guy that conceived the idea for the newspaper, kept changing his job title and his responsibilities, so much so that no one knew whether he was supposed to be leading them or not. Furthermore, people around him seemed to think that what Alan cared about was different to the opinions of a broad audience, meaning that his colleagues and his employees were reluctant to listen to any of his ideas, thus making him not a very good leader. According to Mintzberg's management roles, the interpersonal role is about establishing the relationships inside and outside of the business. The ever-changing leader of the News on Sunday failed to do this, resulting in clashing of opinions and making it difficult for decisions to be made. In contrast, the proprietor of the Mail on Sunday set clear tasks for employees. You had well-defined jobs, thorough training, and this led them to successfully redesign the newspaper to provide an appropriate and innovative direction for the organisation. Now I'm going to pass you on to Chris, who's got more management.
Well, after that, I will explain external environment analysis, which may lead to the business success. Well, managers can consider the situation and which external factors are most likely to affect business. If it is positive, they could take advantage of them. If it's not, they should manage the situation carefully. So these two environments are from past analysis and may have a significant impact on newspaper development. So the politics are closely related to the newspaper industry. And the News on Sunday base itself on the public and attempt to be the first radical newspaper to change Britain. However, they lost their reliability because they failed to represent equal ownership and reduce the unemployment. By contrast, the Mail on Sunday has successfully located in London and had a better reader base, which means it has a strong advantage in the future development. Then let's move on to the social environment. As we know, the positive social image could build a reputation for the company and increase the circulation, while the negative one could strongly influence the customer's attitude and even affect the supply of the newspaper. So what if you read your newspaper on Sunday morning and the biggest title is No Ties but a Lot of Bulbs? Is this a newspaper reliable? It could be a really famous slogan now, but it really been rude for the women in the past and destroyed the brand image. Then let's move on to the human resources management. As we know, it aims at increasing productivity and improving quality by increasing the organization's competitiveness. So let's take the Mail on Sunday as an example. It knows the importance of that, and so they first brought in the Daily Mail's editor, David, and he brought in some well-trained journalists to guide their staff to maximize the efficiency of the organization. However, the inexperienced staff could threaten the development of News on solve the emerging problems. And finally, also the most important thing is the marketing. So let's see. I will mainly explain product and penetration price from the basic 4Ps and to introduce some basic information about the newspaper industry. The core product of the newspaper is to provide information and news to publics with accuracy and reflect the community. But the both News on Sunday and Mail on Sunday failed to achieve their target at the beginning. But the difference is the News on Sunday decided to use the advertisement, while the Mail on Sunday decided to use the deep market investigation to think about the unique selling point, try to make their newspaper different from others, and to redesign, relaunch their newspaper to be suitable for all the readers. And finally, it's penetration pricing. It is because the companies need to explore the market, so they set a really low price to encourage high sales and make developed our customers a buying habit in the future. So it could increase its popularity in the newspaper market and increase its sales. And finally, we will be